Happy Thursday, War Eagles. So, AMI continues. Our story, The Ugly Duckling, should come to an end today. And we should be able to get to our second part here, which would be assessment. So, we're going to finish up annotating, and then there will be a Google form for you to answer. again, try to work on your own. And then tomorrow we will reflect and do our journal entry, which I think is a really interesting topic. So I'm excited about that tomorrow. So now it's time to transition. Hold on, let me get my seat right. I don't feel like I'm like right up on you. Pull up on me. So anyway, those are videos that my kids play for me. All right, so we got a transition. I have a theme song for us today. You know, that's one of our big skills, is to be able to read a piece and determine the theme of the story. And I must say, I really like this song a lot. And this one's from 1963. Her name is Leslie Gore. I'm going to go ahead and get that started. And then I'm going to flash the lyrics up here with a quote. And I want you to read through the lyrics as you're listening to the first little bit of the song. Read the quote. See what you think the theme of the song and the quote are. So here we go. Let's start our video.
You don't own me. I'm not just one of your many toys. You don't own me. Don't say I can't go with other boys. And don't tell me what to do. Don't tell me what to say. And please, when I go out with you, don't put me on display. You don't own me. Don't try to change me in any way. You don't own me. Don't tie me down, cause I never stay. I don't tell you what to say. I don't tell you what to do. So just let me be myself.
So, love that song. It's one of my favorites. Do you like my little lip sync in there? Clearly, I'm not going to be doing that professionally. Anyway, so our song, kind of key phrases in here that stuck out to me. Don't try to change me. Don't tie me down. Don't make me, you know, be who you want me to be. I'm young and I love to be young. I'm free and I love to be free. So sort of, you know, who we really are shining through. So that's our kind of key phrases that point to maybe what the theme of this song might be. If we come over here to this quote, so you're a little weird. Work it. A little different. Own it. Better to be a nerd than one of the herd. Never has there been a truer statement spoken. So if we had to look at both of these and say, you know, like if we were asked, what is the common theme here? What can we say? And I'm thinking we could say something along the lines of be who you really are. Because truly that's what's important, is to be true to yourself. We could say another theme is not fitting in is kind of painful. And I think that's supported by our story. If you don't fit in, if you're not, excuse me, there's things blowing around in my garage. If you don't fit in, if you aren't the same as everybody else, you look a little different or you act a little different, it's painful. You know, people don't readily accept you. They question you. They talk bad about you. They exclude you. That happens. Happens to the best of us. I can certainly say I've experienced that several times in my own life. But you know what? They made me who I am today. I'm a stronger person because of them. So, great. Again, our story structure, we are probably right in here where we're getting close to, you know, the climax. The duck's got to change. Like right now, we were introduced to him, you know, a story. We were in the farmyard. The animals didn't accept him because he was different. We've had lots of examples of him trying to find a place where he fit in, and he keeps failing. So again, our character is not successful. This is important. This is the key part of rising action, is our attempts, and the attempts are not successful. It's what keeps us reading. But eventually we're going to get tired of that, and so we need him to change. We need him to do something different, to either succeed or just to be a miserable failure. So that needs to happen here. And then we're going to start wrapping up those loose ends once he makes that change. And then we're going to deliver our message there in the concluding parts and the resolution. So today, again, yesterday we kind of focused on characterization. We'll still look at that. But really today I want you to notice symbolism. So we're going to have some, you know, symbols in here. And symbols represent a bigger idea. Roses represent love. Books represent knowledge. Trees represent life. So those are symbols. So we've probably got some symbolism going in here in the second part today, and I want us to be on the lookout for that. Thinking about characterization, the skill that we worked on yesterday, let's look at this sentence, and I want you to tell me which words in here communicate sort of what the duck is feeling. What are his desires? So the duckling sat in a corner, feeling very low-spirited, till the sunshine and the fresh air came into the room through the open door, and then he began to feel such a great longing for a swim on the water that he could not help telling the hen. So take a minute, or not a minute in this video would be like a lifetime. So take a second, look at those words. And hopefully you're zooming in right here, because this essentially is what's communicating what our character wants. And what information can we gather from this desire? What do we know about him? One, he's not living his true life. He's an imposter in all of these other situations. He doesn't feel at home. He feels like an outsider. He feels awkward. Those are all inferences we are making from this little detail right here. And those inferences are about our character and what his feelings are about his situation. Again, a very important skill. All really good readers are always doing this. So this is why we practice this all the time. So we get in the habit. Every time we read, we're thinking, okay, what does that really mean? What can I think about that? Okay. Your assessment today is going to be in a Google form. It'll be called the Ugly Duckling Assessment, and it will be in Google Classroom. I need you to do your best, and I need you to not cheat. I need to see what you know. I've said this in class 1,000 times. The only person you're in competition with is yourself. The results from the assessment let you know whether or not you still need to practice. So this is important information for you. Yes, it tells me that you're working and you're making attempts, but truly the one who needs it is you. Right now, guys, you're the driver. Consider this, that, you know, the situation as one where we fast-tracked you into adulthood. Working in college or independent, You have to be the one who takes charge. You have to be the one who makes sure that you're still turning into a smarter, better version of you every day, whether that's physically, emotionally, spiritually, academically. You're the driver right now. So you are going to have to commit to coming to see me in these videos and doing the Google assessment and doing the journal entry. That's how I am communicating your efforts. So please make sure that you're doing this, okay? I'll do a whole video tomorrow about why that's so important. But just know that you need to be doing the Google assessment every week and you need to be doing the journal entry every week. You don't have to watch the videos. They're strictly here as support for you. Maybe they're kind of entertaining because I'm so weird. Guys, if you take the assessment and you do horrible, please don't beat yourself up. That's why you're here. We're here to learn. If we all knew this already, we wouldn't be here. So we're here because we need to learn. Make sure that you're writing down questions so that when we have Google Meets, you can ask me those or you can email those at, you know, 8 to 4 every single day. I'm available via email. So you just type up that little question and I'll type you up an answer. Sometimes I go eat and sometimes I have to go yell at my kids to do their homework. Feel like that's probably happening to y'all too. And anyway, and then tomorrow we're going to do our journal. So just kind of a quick, you know, run through of what you need to do when we finish up our annotating today. Here we go, guys. Let's begin and get this potty started.
So the duckling left the cottage and soon found water on which it could swim and dive, but was avoided by all other animals because of its ugly appearance. Autumn came, and the leaves in the forest turned to orange and gold. Then, as winter approached, the wind caught them as they fell and whirled them in the cold air. The clouds, heavy with hail and snowflakes, hung low in the sky, and the ravens stood on the ferns, crying, "Croak, croak." It made one shiver with cold to look at him. All this was very sad for the poor little duckling. One evening, just as the sun set amid radiant clouds, there came a large flock of beautiful birds out of the bushes. The duckling had never seen any like them before. They were swans, and they curved their graceful necks while their soft plumage shone with dazzling whiteness. They uttered a singular cry as they spread their glorious wings and flew away from those cold regions to warmer countries across the sea. As they mounted higher and higher in the air, the ugly little duckling felt quite a strange sensation as he watched them. He whirled himself in the water like a wheel, stretched out his neck towards them, and uttered a cry so strange that it frightened himself. Could he ever forget those beautiful, happy birds? And when at last they were out of his sight, he dived under the water and rose again almost beside himself with excitement. He knew not the names of these birds, nor where they had flown, but he felt towards them as he had never felt for any other bird in the world. He was not envious of these beautiful creatures, but wished to be as lovely as they. Poor ugly creature, how gladly he would have lived even with the ducks had they only given him encouragement. The winter grew colder and colder. He was obliged to swim about on the water to keep it from freezing, but every night the space on which he swam became smaller and smaller. At length it froze so hard that the ice in the water cracked as he moved, and the duckling had to paddle with his legs as well as he could to keep the space from closing up. He became exhausted at last and lay still and helpless, frozen fast in the ice. Early in the morning, a peasant who was passing by saw what had happened. He broke the ice in pieces with his wooden shoe and carried the duckling home to his wife. The warmth revived the poor little creature, but when the children wanted to play with him, the duckling thought they would do him some harm. So he started up in terror, fluttered into the milk pan, and splashed the milk about the room. Then the woman clapped her hands, which frightened him still more. He flew first into the butter cask, then into the meal tub, and out again. What a condition he was in. The woman screamed and struck at him with the tongs. The children laughed and screamed and tumbled over each other in their efforts to catch him, but luckily he escaped. The door stood open. The poor creature could just manage to slip out among the bushes and lie down quite exhausted in the newly fallen snow. It would be very sad were I to relate all the misery and privations which the poor little duckling endured during the hard winter, but when it had passed, he found himself lying one morning in a moor, amongst the rushes. He felt the warm sun shining and heard the lark singing and saw that all around was beautiful spring. Then the young bird felt that its wings were strong as he flapped them against his sides and rose high into the air. They bore him onwards until he found himself in a large garden before he well knew how it had happened. The apple trees were in full blossom, and the fragrant elders bent their long green branches down to the stream, which wound round a smooth lawn. Everything looked beautiful in the freshness of early spring. From a thicket close by came three beautiful white swans, rustling their feathers and swimming lightly over the smooth water. The duckling remembered the lovely birds and felt more strangely unhappy than ever. "I will fly to these royal birds," he exclaimed, "and they will kill me because I am so ugly and dare to approach them. But it does not matter. Better be killed by them than pecked by the ducks, beaten by the hens, pushed about by the maiden who feeds the poultry, or starved with hunger in the winter." Then he flew to the water and swam towards the beautiful swans. The moment they espied the stranger, they rushed to meet him with outstretched wings. "Kill me," said the poor bird, and he bent his head down to the surface of the water and awaited death. But what did he see in the clear stream below? His own image. No longer a dark gray bird, ugly and disagreeable to look at, but a graceful and beautiful swan. To born in a duck's nest in a farmyard is of no consequence to a bird if it is hatched from a swan's egg. He now felt glad at having suffered sorrow and trouble, because it enabled him to enjoy so much better all the pleasure and happiness around him. For the great swans swam around the newcomer and stroked his neck with their beaks as a welcome. Into the garden presently came some little children and threw bread and cake into the water. "See," cried the youngest, "there is a new one." And the rest were delighted and ran to their father and mother, dancing and clapping their hands and shouting joyously, "There's another swan come. A new one has arrived." Then they threw more bread and cake into the water and said, "The new one is the most beautiful of all. He is so young and pretty." And the old swans bowed their heads before him. Then he felt quite ashamed and hid his head under his wing, for he did not know what to do. He was so happy and yet not at all proud. He had been persecuted and despised for his ugliness, and now he heard them say he was the most beautiful of all the birds. Even the elder tree bent down its boughs into the water before him, and the sun shone warm and bright. Then he rustled his feathers, curved his slender neck, and cried joyfully from the depths of his heart, "I never dreamed of such happiness as this while I was an ugly duckling."
So, here we go. Let's talk a little bit about what's going on here. So again, when we started this section, he had already been, you know, he had left his brood, his brothers and sisters who were kind of picking on him, to the farmyard where he got picked on some more. Then he flew off and he ended over here with the cat and the hen. They were really mean to him. So here we are, and he's like, "I got to get out of here." So then, and they wanted him to like purr and lay eggs. And he said, "Well, I can't do that." So he left. And, you know, you can see here that we get details about the seasons. So we have autumn and winter. Remember we talked about symbolism? Seasons change. Sometimes in life, we have seasons, and some of those seasons can be cold and sad, sort of like winter, bare, a lot of isolation and inward. Sound familiar? Like right now. And then we have summer and spring, which are full of life, just like in nature. So the seasons can be symbolic of seasons of life. And we see he's going through kind of a rough season right now. And that's why we see autumn and winter. But the good thing about seasons, they change. They're not going to last forever. So we know that there's a change coming up. All right, we've got another automatopoeia here. We'll just do this. So we know that, again, we have a lot of examples of those. Good job at the setting, because not only can we see what the farmyard looks like or what the forest looks like or what the lake looks like, but now we know what sounds are associated with that. It gives the reader a richer experience with the setting. All right, big word here, plumage. Plumage. The duckling had never seen any like them before. They were swans, and they curved their graceful necks while their soft plumage shone a dazzling whiteness. Clue here, whiteness. What color are swans? They're white. What makes them white? They're white feathers. So possibly, just quite possibly, plumage might mean feathers. The ugly duckling felt quite a strange sensation as he watched them. So we're getting clues about him feeling more comfortable as he sees other swans. He felt towards them as he had never felt for any other bird in the world. So again, he's starting to feel like he belongs. And that's a really important emotion for people, to feel like they belong to either a group of friends or a family or a work community, or in our case, a school community. So connecting with each other is important for a lot of students, you know, because we're a community, and we don't have our community with us right now. And so we feel like a duck out of water. I'm full of them today, guys. Yes. I'm not even charging for this entertainment. Can you believe it? Okay. So, you can tell though that he's tired, right? We talked about this rising action. He's exhausted, man. And he even says that, you know, he lays there exhausted. He's on this little bit of water. He didn't know to fly south because he's not with his homies. So misdirected, exhausted, and tired. He lays down, almost dies, but luckily a stranger gets him. What condition he was in, so they nurse him back to health. And this is a great paragraph where he's kind of going crazy in the house as he's trying to get out of there. He's all panicky and stuff. Again, that's the, building up to the change that's about to happen. So again, we've got the seasons changing, right? And so is our little duckling. And then we've got his condition sort of culminating into this high point of panic. And he's running out of the house. And as he does, you know, they start to talk about how he learned how to fly. Like, he just started flapping his wings and then he took off. So coming to these realizations that, you know, he's a great swimmer, he's a good flyer, he's had all these hints that you're a swan this whole time. This first sentence in paragraph 32, it would be very sad were I to relate all the misery and privations which the poor little duckling endured during the hard winter. But when it had passed, he found himself lying one morning in a moor amongst the rushes. So again, this word privations, it's coupled with misery. So again, if we know what misery means, then it's probably not a real far stretch to figure out what privations are. Using, you know, the key phrases in here, he's had a hard winter. That would cause misery and privations, doing without things. Deprived. All right, so as he was flying, though, he really felt terrible. He said the duckling remembered the lovely birds, and he felt really unhappy. So he's run out of this house. He's flying now, and he's just miserable. And then lo and behold, he finds another set of birds. And he's just going to call it quits. He's like, you know what? They're all going to bite me. So I'm just going to go and hang out with those at least I liked. I thought they were really pretty. I would rather go there than with the ducks or the hens or the maid. So this paragraph 33, highlight this one. This has got a great example of parallel structure in it. I will fly to these royal birds and they will kill me because I am so ugly and dare to approach them. But it does not matter. Ah, look at that. A colon. I know you remember this from our poster in the classroom, which we haven't seen in a while. It introduces a list. Every item in that list needs to be similar in format. So let's see if they are. Better be killed by them than pecked by the ducks, beaten by the hens, pushed about by the maiden who feeds the poultry, or starved with hunger in the winter. Notice you've got a list of verbs. They're all past tense. Pecked, beaten, pushed, starved. Keep this in mind when you're writing your journal entry tomorrow when I ask you to use parallel structure. Here's an example. All right, you know, and then he's just expecting, because he's a creature of habit, we all are, he's expecting the worst because that's what's happened everywhere else. So he just lays down and says, go ahead and kill me. But the change happens. This is the climax. Remember, we said the character changes. So how does he change? Let's look. But he saw himself for the first time. And he realized that he was a swan. Holy cow. Or holy geese. And so he, you know, has this great aha moment. And let's highlight it here. I think this one's really important. So let's do this one in blue. I think this might even kind of be our lesson here. He now felt glad at having suffered sorrow and trouble because it enabled him to enjoy so much better all the pleasure and happiness around him. For the great swan swam around the new corner and stroked his neck with their beaks as a welcome. So again, being miserable, being left out, served a purpose in his life. It made him really appreciate the good things because he knew how bad things could be. He knew how, you know, lonely it is to not have a group of friends around. And so he's very appreciative of the people who now want to hang out with him. Notice we've got some alliteration here. Swan swam. I've asked you to use alliteration in your journal entry tomorrow. So this is when two words have the same sound at the beginning, but they're side by side or very close in the sentence. So tomorrow in your journal entry, use a list, try to make everything in your list the same, and use some alliteration. All right, so then my favorite part is when he finally is seen by the kids and they're like, oh my God, he's the prettiest one of all. He's very humble. This is, you know, very embarrassing and awkward for him because he's never had any attention. Everybody's always, well, I mean, he has, but it's always been mean and not very nice. And so this one is different. He had been prosecuted and despised for his ugliness, and now he heard them say he was the most beautiful of all the birds. So he changed, just like our seasons changed, just like our situation will change, and we will go back to school. All right, my friends, this is the end of the story. So now it is time for you to go do your Google form. So I'm going to post this video and your Google form. I'll see you tomorrow for Journal Entry Friday. Peace out, homies.